My first involvement with the 101 project was when my boss called me in one day to ask me if I was particularly busy, sort of thing he used to ask from time to time. And at the time I was working on the winding up of the Lynx project in Egypt, and we were just handing it over to the lawyers so they could get busy. So there wasn't much left for us to do. And he said, well, could you fit in something else for the moment? We just need somebody to go up to London to work on something for a short period. Be about 6 months and then you can come back and we'll sort out what else you're going to do. So I got ready, went up to London, joined the office up there, and it was 17 years before I came back down to the factory. One of the features of the early part of the programme was interminable negotiations trying to establish MOUs with the government, intercompany agreements between us and Augusta. And we were always sitting in conference rooms waiting for things to happen and having a little bit of discussion, then everyone would go off and think about it for a while and then we'd get together again. And in one of these moments of pause, one of the guys in the Westland team was scribbling on a piece of paper. And he drew a little stick man. And this little stick man was running frantically across the page. And on his head, he had a hat which enabled this man to write Westland on it. And around the ankle of this little running stick man was a ball and chain. And the ball and chain dragged out behind him. And on the ball and chain was written Augusta. And just as he finished writing it, one of the Augusta team, who we were discussing with at the time, walked around the back of him, looked down at the piece of paper, and quick as a flash, he drew underneath the little man and just in front of him, a precipice. And it was quite clear that Augusta felt they were saving Westland from running into a disaster by not thinking clearly what they were doing. And it just, that summed up for me the relationship we had between the companies all the way through. It was always one company thinking they were doing the other one some good, and the other one could never quite understand it.
Here we come upon a modular constructive aircraft that we've never dealt with before. A hell of a lot of different materials, and we had to do it in conjunction with Augusta. And we had many a stormy meeting with Augusta in the nicest possible way. We got on like house on fire because we were the people at the bottom of the tree, as you might, and they ran a different system to us. So in which case we had to have all these interfaces all over the aircraft so that our gear could go into like PP1 and 3 and 4 and 5, and theirs went into PP2 and so forth. It sounded quite straightforward, but when you realize there's 11,500 cables of instrumentation alone on PP1, you'll get a fairly good idea of what went on.
I was fortunate to be involved in the very first flight of PP1, in October 1987. The first flight of any new type of aircraft is a high point in any test pilot's career, and this was certainly the high point of mine. There were four of us on board, myself, Trevor Eggington, who was the chief test pilot at the time, and the two flight list engineers, Joe Andrewoffer and Malcolm Pester, and all of us had been working on the aircraft during the ground running period for some months prior to the first flight. But nonetheless, the first flight is always a very exciting experience. It was relatively uneventful, which was just the way it should be, but during those few days that we got the aircraft into the air for the first time and into forward flight, which was really properly the first flight, we were very aware of how much work had gone into this aircraft by many thousands of people, both here at Yeovil and in Italy. It was a great success, the first flight, but it showed us how much more development we had to do, but it also gave us some clues what a great aircraft this was going to turn out to be.
I mean, we were all out on the pad, you know, we were all sort of, you know, sort of there. And I think the whole factory turned out, actually. Yeah. And they were up on the pad, and that was a sight to see. And I'm sure there's photographs somewhere. But however, that was really a fantastic sight. I mean, that is something that I should carry for the rest of my life, because obviously it was everybody was there, because everybody played a part. I mean, all right, we were out there. But we didn't build the aircraft. The aircraft were built here. All the spares, or most of the spares, were made. I know some were made in Italy. But, I mean, everybody participated. And it was fantastic. It really was.
The instrumentation design team were a very dedicated group of people who stayed with the team for years and years simply because of the interest that there was in that aspect of design. And I was very fortunate in having those sort of people to see us right through.
I joined flight test in 1988, just after PP3 first flew, and I came from Nimrods, which was an aircraft with very similar sensors to the pre-production Merlin, but 10 more crew, which gives some idea of the advance that the Merlin was in terms of the avionics. My favourite PP aircraft was PP5. It was the original mission system development aircraft, and it retired in July 2000. I flew almost 600 hours on PP5. Although not many people realise it, they've all seen my face in the window of a Merlin. In the early days, PP5 was lined up for a film with a Type 23 frigate in the background, and I was sat in the starboard window watching the chase aircraft. So in many Merlin pictures, there's this little chap in the back, which I think is a good thing. It reminds anyone who sees it that the Merlin really is just a transport for the sensors and the sensor operators to catch and kill a submarine. We'll be right back.
during the period at Augusta. I think I'm probably the only pilot that actually managed to get his backside into all nine aircraft, all nine PP aircraft. And on one occasion, I remember we set off for an exercise, and shortly after takeoff, we'd climbed up to 3,000-4,000 feet, going along the lake, going past Lake Varese, just south of the city, and there was a bang, and I was sitting in the left-hand seat at the time in PP2, and the window on my side suddenly decided it wanted to depart the aircraft. And so I had to grab the window very smartly, and it was, with the speed we were flying, it was quite a pull to try and keep the window in place. So we slowed right down, and the only sight we could find was a little gliding field just on the edge of Lake Varese. So we told Milan that we were doing an emergency landing and popped into this gliding field, much to the surprise of the Italian glider pilots, because I don't think they'd ever had anything quite so heavy in their airfield before. So we resecured the window and continued with the flight. The final part of the single side operation came with the first adventurous flight, if you like, in the 101, where we had to deliver it, a prototype aircraft back to the UK. And our option was to either go across the Alps towards Lausanne and then back up to UK, or go down to Nice. As it turned out on the day, the weather was fine and with a nice high cloud base, sunny, and it was in March, which was surprising weather for that time of year in Italy. Having climbed out of Malpensa, we flew up Lago Maggiore and then followed the route up to Domodossola and the Simplon Pass. Fortunately, with a cloud base of some 10,000 feet, so we were absolutely stunning views across the Alps. We could see the Jungfrau and the Eiger sticking up above us, even at the height we were. And in fact, the aircraft worked perfectly the whole way. We had no problems, no faults, and we were very impressed with the for a PP aircraft to do that sort of journey so early in its development program.
One of the more amusing incidents I remember flying the VIPs was when we were fetching John Major and Chancellor Cole from Northolt in London and flying them out to their house at Chequers for lunch. Now, Chancellor Cole, as you may know, is quite a large gentleman, and the greatest difficulty we had on that flight was making sure that we had a seat that was big enough for him and a seat belt that would go round it without making it too obvious that we were actually preparing this for a very fat chap. Anyway, we managed it in the end, but that was by far my most worrying moment of the whole flight, not the actual flight itself, where the weather was very marginal as well. But we had a very nice lunch at Chequers.
One of the aspects of the head camera was to look down the blade at the strain gauge that was on there to ensure that all was well, and it threw up some very unusual pictures. And when we came to climatic trials with cameras all over the place, looking at main head rotor, tail rotor, engine intakes, the icing conditions trials have proved how good the EH101 is in icing conditions, and but for all this installation and the cameras provided, one wouldn't have known and might not have got the full survey.
The aircraft is now almost fully in service with our own services, with the Royal Air Force, with the Royal Navy, with the Canadians. Three very different roles, which we designed the aircraft for from its very outset. And it's with enormous pride that I see that four of the naval aircraft are embarked on their way out to do the role perhaps that we envisaged so many years ago. and the Air Force are preparing their aircraft, perhaps, to go out and participate in the many roles that aircraft can do.
We've had a lot of technical achievements, a lot of brilliant engineering going on, a lot of fantastic performances in continually delivering and flying aircraft on Christmas Eve, which has always been one of our favourite occupations. But I find still, I mean, it did at the beginning of the programme, but still now I get a bit of a lump in my throat when I see what the aircraft can do. Not that I feel, and I think it's very impressive when I see the aircraft flying across the airfield in formation, I see us doing long trips with the aircraft to demonstrate how far it'll go. The cross-Atlantic flight that Jerry Tracy did was hugely impressive, but that didn't make me feel emotional, because it seemed to be that's the skill that we have, that's what we do, and we do it very well. The things that really, really come home to me, and it still happened again today when I was reading a report this morning, that there was another rescue conducted by one of the cormorants in Canada. And the reports from the crew were that they couldn't possibly have done it with the previous aircraft. This aircraft's so much easier to use. It enabled them to pick up all the survivors off the aircraft, off the ship in one move, instead of having to fly back and come back again and risk losing one of them. It just, that sort of thing still brings home to me, you know, that it's all been worthwhile and it's been a wonderful aircraft to work on. And it still brings a lump to my throat, I'm afraid.